Good morning, beloved of God. Is anyone out there? Hello. I don't know if any of you have heard of laminin. Have you heard of laminin? Yeah? It's a cell adhesion protein molecule that holds the body together. And it's in the shape of a cross. And this is not new news, but I was just reading something this week, and it was that the DNA has the name of God written on it. And I'm not going to go into the details because that is just too much for me to explain. But it just struck me that, you know, it says in the Bible that we're fearfully and wonderfully made, and God has said that we're tattooed on his hand, but he's actually tattooed his mark on us. Our creation, our very being, is held together by him in reality. And I just think that's amazing, isn't it? That he is so intentionally invested in our creation, and that just puts so much value on us. Even if we didn't get it from the cross, it's just the story of God all the way through, right from the very beginning. And then I was reading John 14, verse 6, and it says, Jesus said, and this is a verse we're really familiar with, Jesus explained, I am the way, I am the true reality, and I am the life. No one comes next to the Father except through union with me. To know me is to know my Father too. And from now on, you will realize that you have seen him and have experienced him. And something that was highlighted to me in the notes was that Jesus does more than take us to heaven. He brings us next to the Father. The Father is the destination. And, you know, that is, we sing of God's greatness, and he's amazing, but he's come near to us, and he invites us to draw closer to him. So let's draw closer to him with our hearts as we sing about who he is and what he's done and who we are because of him.
How great are you, Lord? How great is your mercy? How great are the things that you have done for me? How great are you, Lord? Your loving kindness. Thank you. sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again, victorious. Faithfulness none can deny. Through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. No beginning and no end. You're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost. You paid it all upon the cross. No beginning and no end. You're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost. You paid it all upon the cross. You are strong.
Father, we thank you. We thank you that you have lifted us up out of the miry clay. You've established us on the rock that is Jesus. And that as we become all that you created us to be, we lift your name up higher. We exalt your name. Thank you. Thank you that you have taken what you have created and you have set your love and affection and your intentionality upon. We are blessed to be called your children. And we bless you, our Father. Amen.
Good morning, church. And welcome to anyone visiting with us this morning. Please join us for a cuppa after the service in the hall. We'd love to get to know you better. Please observe the COVID safe program by remaining seated at the tables while you will be served with your tea and coffee. Also, a reminder to everyone to register your attendance at church this morning by way of the Queensland app or by having your name registered with the welcomer at the door. Thank you for your cooperation in this matter. Birthdays this week, we have Bev. Happy birthday, Bev. There you are. And Lofty. Lofty's having a birthday. Oh, they're out the back. So happy birthday, Lofty. No anniversaries. Tomorrow, the senior social will be held, commencing at 9:30 a.m. A musical program will be presented by Jean, so please come along and spend an enjoyable time together. Connect group will meet Tuesday and Friday mornings at 9:30. KYB ladies will meet at 9:30 Wednesday morning and the evening group at 7:15. ASD support group will meet on Thursday evening, 5th of August, 7:30 in the Oasis room. And Saturday, 7th of August at 3 p.m, not 2 p.m. as previously advertised, there'll be a mission workshop where Ross Farley, and with Ross Farley, entitled What is the Great Commission? For more information, pick up the flyer. There'll be a couple on the back table here in the mission corner if you're interested in going. And the mission committee will meet on the 9th of August at 1 p.m. in the Oasis room. Come along and join us as we share a time with Leanne and Gary and hear about some of the work that they've been doing in regional Queensland. This afternoon at 2 o'clock, we'll be meeting for a concert of prayer. And for those who dare, you want to wear a pair of walking shoes. Curious? Come along and find out more. Last Sunday, we held the first of the five-part series on sharing our faith. This second part of the series, entitled Courageous, will be conducted next Sunday, the 8th at 2:30. It's not too late to join the group. You will be made most welcome. This weekend, Carry Us Outside is being held at Camp Pyalba. This is a ministry to women whose lives and families have been affected by loved ones who have been incarcerated. Please pray for these women and especially for the team as they support these women as they discover the transforming love and forgiveness of Jesus. Please pray especially for Janet, who is one of the team leaders, that she will be strengthened spiritually and physically as she serves her Lord in this important ministry. For any other information and dates to remember, just check your bulletin. Thank you.
Okay, so it's that time of year again that we're starting to get ready for the Maribyrrh Madness Camp. So for those who don't know, Maribyrrh Madness is a camp for grades 5 and 6 kids and it's held out at the Aldershot Scout campsite. And these are mostly kids who've never been to church before. And it's run by people like Troy through the school chaplaincy program with Scripture Union. And we aim to have a lot of fun, as you can see, but reach kids for Christ. And we would love your support. And there is, with your bulletin this week, is a ways that you can support Maryborough Madness. So prayer is the main thing that we need all the time. And do you guys have anything you want to say about?
Along with prayer, and there's also financial support that can help with the funding for the camp, but also accommodation is a big deal this year because of COVID. So we have to create even more space than what we did last year, and we have to find places for, well, in the area, like caravans that people want to lend us for the week, for leaders and also for kids. So that's a pretty big deal for us. If we don't have enough accommodation for people to stay in for the week, then you know, we can't have as many kids on camp. So if you could help with the prayers for that sort of blessing for camp, then Troy says bacon. I don't know why. Food. Oh, okay. If you feel like you want to give some food, some bacon, like bickies and cakes and stuff, then feel free to, you know, give it to us, because Troy will love that. Clearly.
All right, I think that's it. But thank you.
Well, that's great, isn't it? Oh, Merriman, I wish I was 10. Oh, but God is good, isn't he? And all the time, God is good. He's a God whose compassions never fail. Do you realise that? Oh, that's so good when we just not seem to be right with the Lord, or not walking just right, or things go wrong. We just know his compassions never fail. And so we're going to come to this wonderful God in prayer. And it also says, these compassions are new every morning. I don't have to use yesterday's compassion. They're new every morning. And then it caps it all up with, great is your faithfulness. So let's come to God in prayer. Father, we thank you so much today that there's a throne of grace in the heavenly tabernacle to which we can come today in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that we can come and we can receive mercy. We can put our hands out and say, Lord, we've failed you this week. We haven't done what you wanted us to do. We've done things that we are disappointed in. Father, forgive us. Father, let your compassion pour over us and meet our needs today. And Father, we thank you too that we can come to this throne of grace and find grace to help. Father, we've been praying for so many of our number, our church people who have been sick and have had appointments. And Father, you've answered those prayers. We just want to thank you today, Father. We thank you that this throne of grace has been effective in prayer for these people. But Lord, we still come for those who still have difficulties in their health, those awaiting test results, praying for wisdom for doctors. Father God, you know who they are. And if there's anyone you know just now that you know needs this help in health, just quietly in your heart, say their name to God in prayer before this throne of grace, and he will hear. And Father, today, hearing about the Maryborough Madness Camp, Lord, we just pray for those from our church who are involved. We pray, Father, that you will just bless that camp. Lord, we want to see kids come to know the Lord while they're young. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth, the Word of God says. Lord, we want them to know the Creator in their days of youth. So, Father, I just pray that you'll bless this camp, bless the leaders, guide and provide in every way. And we want to pray for Janet today down at Harvey Bay at the Kairos outside camp. Lord, these are just the last moments of the camp when things are so crucial. Lord, speak to women, I pray, and let them to know that to find Jesus as the answer to their need. Bless Janet with strength. She'll be so tired just now, having been there since Friday afternoon. And so, Father, give her that extra strength for this last lap, that she might know your presence and your guidance and your grace in her time of need. Lord, we want to pray for the Nanango Church today. We thank you for the Baptist witness in Nanango and pray that you'll be with the health and well-being of this fellowship and you will guide them in all they do. And thank you for the answered prayer and for the repairs that have been affected there. So God, just bless that church and minister through the people to those in the community, I pray. And Father, we just thank you for your word. And we pray that as we sit around your word this morning, you will open out our hearts and let us hear what you want us to hear. And may we be obedient in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning a verse just dropped into my heart and it was in 1 John 3:1 and it's, "Behold, what manner of the love the Father has given unto us, that we would be called children of God." And that is who you are. That is who you are. And we get to be like little kids, little kids that just are joyfully and lovingly accepted by our good Father. I just want to read you a couple of verses. Well, it's the same verse, but it's from a couple of different versions, and it's Romans 5:2. And this is one version. It's the Mirror Bible. "Jesus is God's grace embrace of the entire human race. So here we are standing tall in the joyful bliss of our redeemed innocence. We are God's dream come true." Do you ever think of yourself as that? In the Amplified it says, "Through him we also have access by faith into this remarkable state of grace in which we firmly, safely and securely stand. Let us rejoice in our hope and the confident assurance of experiencing and enjoying the glory of our great God, the manifestation of his excellence and power." And in the Passion it says, "Our faith guarantees us permanent access into this marvelous kindness that has given us a perfect relationship with God. What incredible joy bursts forth within us as we keep on celebrating our hope of experiencing God's glory." That's what we get to respond to. And as we sing these next couple of songs, let them be your heart's response to the goodness of God that has been demonstrated in Jesus and by the power of the Holy Spirit. That our hearts would really be overflowing with amazement that he would love us so.
Your loving kindness I am yours, I am
speak what is true. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak what is true. Speak what is true.
Father, that's our prayer, that you would speak what is true into our hearts today. Father, as Rhys comes, we thank you that our eyes are open and our ears are open to hear your voice.
I'm still wearing the mask this week. My bit of a croak last Sunday morning turned into something that emptied out a box and a half of tissues by about midweek. And I had a COVID test and came back negative, which was really good. But and because I'm such a generous and kind fellow, I shared with my wife and the remainder of the box and a half of tissues that we've had left in the house, she's using quite nicely. So Jackie's not quite so well this morning. Excellent. So my encouragement is, if we do get a bit of a sniffle, what I understand with this Delta stream, apparently one case can lead up to something like 1,800 transmissions. Yeah, it's massively, the contagion of it is more than we could imagine. So let's look after one another and just take those steps that we have to. And this morning, I seriously have a confession to make to you. And the truth of the matter is, and my confession to you is, that I am a foodie. Okay? I love taking photos of food as it cooks to put it up on Facebook or to send to my son Luke or my son-in-law Jack just to make them a little bit jealous of what they're missing out on. I love looking what others put up, not out of a sense of competitiveness or a hint of jealousy, but rather because my depth of appreciation for creativity and the commitment to culinary excellence. I subscribe to at least 3 recipe websites. And I draw on a stack more than that when I'm looking at a special cook-up. I subscribe to at least 4 YouTube sites that kind of talk about how to smoke or grill or slow reverse sear, whatever it is, on the Weber. I'm always kind of updating my database around that stuff. I actually think God got it right when he claimed the fatty bit of the lamb's tail for himself. I reckon he got that right. And the chief priests, I am much jealous. Just imagine the aromas of the burnt offerings of the lambs. Mm-mm. Love it. You know, and the truth of the matter is, I almost read recipe books devotionally. I mean, not that you could tell. You know, there is less of me now than there was a few months back, but I'm working on it. But I love it. I love preparing food. I love working with sharp knives. And Jackie can tell when I'm quite stressed because our knives are that sharp, I can shave with them. Right? Now, at the moment, I have to give them a bit of a lick up before I use them, which should tell you a story that I'm doing pretty good. But I love getting the cuts just right, doing my best to make sure that everything is the same uniform size so it cooks consistently. Or if I'm making a salad, I want all the carrots just to have the right bite. You know, I want it just to be so. Now, and I know Jackie gets quite frustrated with me because, like, she just, what's all the big deal? She walks hustle bustle into the kitchen, chop, 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 chop there. Now, it all tastes the same, right? But, well, the truth of the matter is I think it's probably where my OCD shows, right? But I love the textures, the crunch, the pop, the silky smooth, the chunky, and the fall off the bone tender, huh? I love the taste test, the balancing out of the flavours of the spices, the zing, the citrus, the chilli, the savoury, the complexity of a good curry. Oh, absolutely, Mark. A nice rub or a glaze. I've actually started making my own rubs and stuff, putting spices together and working it out, and my own sauces to glaze up the chicken as you give it the last 15 minutes in the Weber, and it just turns all sticky and tacky and yummy. You know, I love the sizzle of cooking over hot coals on our fire pit. I love the aromas of the cook, unless, of course, it's Sir Stromming. You know, those of you that were read last week, the newsletter article, I referenced Sir Stromming, you know, that canned raw fish delicacy, of Sweden. It's considered by some the most putrid thing in a can. They actually put the fish in a brine, in a can it, and they wait until the can almost explodes before they eat it. Oh, how could you? Talk about enough to put me off, I'll tell you. But even more than all of that, I love the satisfaction of sharing a lovingly prepared meal with friends. We've finally got our family table repaired. I wish my table could talk at home. This table we've had for over 30 years where the varnish has worn off the wood. And I just love sitting there and remembering the conversations and the people and the tears and the joys and the hopes and the dreams and the aspirations and the brokenness. And the ebb and flow of life of our table. The conversation, the relationships, the communion. For me, it doesn't get much better than that. Let's eat. Only joking. We'll get to do that a little bit later. But the meal that the disciples enjoyed in this next story we're looking at today, it's nowhere near as elaborate as I've spelled out, but it was a meal for them nonetheless. However, this story is about more than just food. Let's have a look at it. So, one Sabbath, Jesus, this is from Mark chapter 2, verses 23 to 28. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields. Notice it's the time marker here. It's a Sabbath. Who was Jesus talking to at the moment in the middle of? He's talking to Pharisees. Mark those two things. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields and his disciples walked along and they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" He answered, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions. And then he said to them, 'The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is even Lord of the Sabbath.'" So let's put this story back into its context of the story. Because here we have a series of three stories. In fact, it goes further than that back into chapter chapter 1, where Jesus confronts the holiness code of the priests, and he's just working through the debt system of the scribes, and now he's tackling the Pharisees. The Pharisees, parasites, yeah, pretty much. Well, you see, they weren't, the thing is, the Pharisees were self-designated. They weren't, they weren't appointed by anyone except their own kind. They weren't voted in. They had no real power. They actually, their power came from the strength of their alliances with other power groups. They were a sect in and of themselves, not an official party per se. Quite fascinating. So Jesus, he's undermined the purity code and the debt code of the priests and the scribes in 1:40-45, 2:1-12, those two stories. Now, then he's undermined the Pharisees' claim to their control of law through their teaching, regulation, and their application of law regarding table fellowship, in other words, who you could and couldn't eat with, and fasting. And now he tackles their sacred cow. This is the big one, the Sabbath. So the Sabbath, for us, it's perhaps not such a big deal, but for in their world, it was really big, because on the seventh day of creation, God rested. So the seventh day idea, and to the Jews, this was a big deal. The Sabbath is referred to in 116 verses in the Old Testament. This is a big fella something if we're in the Solomon Islands. And the idea is that 6 days you'll work with God, and with God in your life, 6 days work is equal to more than seven if he's in your life rather than seven if he's not there. So the whole idea of Sabbath, it's actually not about law. It's an expression of trust and grace and relationship. That's its purpose, is those things. You might recall Exodus 31 and 13. You must observe my Sabbaths, because this will be a sign between me and you for the generations to come, so that you may know that I am the Lord who makes you holy. So the Sabbath was never meant to be about law. It was always to be about relationships. And here's an interesting aside. A longitudinal study in America, you know, like over a length of time, study of people in the Seventh-day Adventist Church in the US, it actually established that these Seventh-day Adventist people lived 7 years longer than average. Quite curious. Quite curious. And, you know, for these people, if you add up all their Sabbaths that they observe, it equates those 7 years. It's fascinating, isn't it? You know, we really do need to wage war on hurry. You know, people say to me, oh, you know, I haven't rung you because I know you're busy. Why do you think I'm busy? I always have time for you, except on a Friday. But I have time for you. And if I haven't got time, I will make time. What is it about pastors that they think they have to be forever busy? Where is the modeling of an appropriate work-life balance? You know, if pastors and Christian leaders aren't modeling and waging war on hurry for everybody else, I think it's part of pastoral responsibility to have a good work-life balance. So I don't want people to say to me, oh, pastor, I know you're busy. No. Because if that's what you're saying to me, I am modeling the wrong things. We have to wage war on hurry. We need to reclaim the sacred practices of Sabbath and take time to smell the roses, because it's going to add years to our lives. But anyway, so here's the issue. the issue with the Sabbath. On a Sabbath walk is 2,000 paces, Acts chapter 1 and verse 12, which is around about 1,100 metres, over a kilometre in total. You see, counting steps isn't just a modern fitness thing, you know, your step counter on your watch. But the issue here, picking some heads of grain equals threshing. It amounts to threshing, and threshing amounts to work. Now, Jesus and the disciples, they take on the most important aspect of the Pharisees' program, which is this Sabbath observance. But in all of this, Jesus is introducing a new way of the new beginning, mercy, not sacrifice. And so, over and against this issue that the Pharisees have, why do your disciples do this thing, work on the Sabbath? Jesus mounts a protest. So Mark's Jesus, he's not just deflating the claims of the Pharisees to their regulation of the law. You see, each of the stories in these last three stories has something to do with food. And Jesus just doesn't deflate the Pharisees. He actually defends his followers' right to break bread with the socially outcast. Jesus asserts their rights to ignore non-ritual eating practices of fast. You might remember that on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, the Jews will, that's their annual day of fast, Yom Kippur. And then they would remember devastating days like the 587 BC exile, and they would remember being carted off into exile with a fast. And according to Jeremiah, the Jewish historian, the Pharisees introduced 2 days of fasting on a Monday evening from sundown all day Tuesday, and a Wednesday evening on Sunday all day Thursday. They introduced 2 more days to assert their righteousness. But now Jesus justifies the disciples' rights to break the Sabbath law in situations of hunger. But there's actually even more to it than that, because the Pharisees had projected their own argument that would ultimately become one of the major things that they put as Jesus, why they want to kill him. But it's even more than just the Sabbath and the story that Jesus told. I don't think the Pharisees saw it coming. I don't think they saw it coming. Because Jesus references a story of King David as a special circumstance. And that places Jesus on a par with King David. Hello? Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. It's the Twilight Zone again. That's twice today if you've read your newsletters. But this is a period when Abiathar was the high priest, which locates it to the time when David was on the run from Saul. Think about this, people. Samuel had anointed David king. Saul was jealous. He was pursuing David and his companions. David was in the wilderness, and the scriptures tell us all of the rabble came from the four corners of Israel to join David's crew. This was a period when David's popularity was building while he was waiting for his time to come. Does this sound familiar? Look at what's going on in this story. This has everything to be a bucket of cold, icy water over the heads of the Pharisees. They weren't expecting for Jesus to tell this story. This is massive. David, on the run from Saul, gathering support, waiting for his time to come. It's a huge claim. But the Pharisees understood the implications that Jesus is the true king. They implicitly understood it. And he was about to say as much, because you see, there is a new beginning. And Jesus says to them, listen, man wasn't made for the Sabbath. Sabbath was made for man. The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. And this is the second time in Mark that Mark records Jesus self-referencing as the Son of Man. The first time was in Mark chapter 2, 1 to 12. And to show you the extent of the authority of the Son of Man, which is easier. Pick up your mat and walk, or I forgive your sin. But to show you the authority of the Son of Man can even forgive sin on earth, I tell you, pick up your mat and walk, and the guy gets up and walks out. The Son of Man. You know, I was studying my primary degree. I studied theology for 3 years before I understood it. True. My confession. And the thing that helped me understand theology was the Son of Man. Because if you go back and you look at Daniel 7:14, one in the midst who approaches the Ancient of Days, God's name was so holy you couldn't mention it. But there was one who had the appearance of a Son of Man. And this one was given sovereign authority. He was the object of the worship of all nations. Now, for the Jew, that was a massive problem. Because what's the first commandment? Worship only God. So who must this Son of Man be? It's that simple. It's that simple. This Son of Man is God. And they knew it. And they killed him, knowing it. And you know what the sadness is? We would have too. Son of Man, Lord of the Sabbath. Well, actually, he's Lord of the whole house. He's Lord of the whole house. And so, for us, we can actually confuse complicity with humility. I mean, Jesus was certainly humble. But he reveals to us that there are times where truth needs to be spoken to power. There are times for legitimate protest. And there's a contemporary question to speak that this speaks into while we're here. And that is selective lawlessness ever the way of Jesus? So to apply that question, can we say the recent public protests we've witnessed both in Washington and Sydney are okay? I mean, in the case of storming of Capitol Hill in Washington, And I'm about to make this observation, but with the statement, I have no political interest whatsoever. Democrat, Republican, no political interest. And perhaps I shouldn't even comment because it's not my country. Perhaps. But there's a lot of people that claim this is precedent. And I just feel I need to say a couple of things here. Because what I've saw and I've read on both sides, and I remember seeing a placard at the head of the front line that moves up Capitol Hill with a placard there, Jesus saves. and there are a number of other religious propaganda type statements, as if bringing God into their actions was legitimizing what they did. But you see, this is what the priests and the scribes and the Pharisees did. So I conclude that that moment that America faced was about nationalism, not Christianity. It was about nationalism. It's an event that's now called terrorist by their own courts, largely dominated by Republicans. It's been proven to have been led by evangelical Christians. Can't believe it. And I'll try to give these people the benefit of the doubt and accept that perhaps they were being sincere. But I think they were being sincerely wrong. Sincerely wrong. They mistakenly, and I concede perhaps even unwittedly, swapped their national flag for the cross. Yes, there are times where the civil disobedience of justice, mercy, and compassion is called for. In our lifetimes, we've seen the civil rights movement in America being led by Martin Luther King Jr. Non-violent protest, justice, mercy, and compassion. We've seen Mohandas Gandhi and his non-violent opposition of human rights abuses in India. And more recently in Australia, we've seen the justice claim of Eddie Mabo around Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, land rights. And all of that, I think, is more than reasonable and legitimate and an expression of justice, mercy, compassion, and respect. Respectfulness. But none of these other two incidences were. The one in Washington and what we saw last weekend in Sydney. I understand yesterday's protest march was called off just as well. Not helpful. But these are evidences of people who are acting out of misinformation and frustration, not justice. They were expressions of people who couldn't get their own way with a veiled mind for the well-being of others. And it's exactly the type of thing Jesus was exposing. So enough of that. You see, Jesus' way pardon me. Jesus' way is a new beginning in the way of grace. Looking out for the poor and needy. And I trust that as we continue, that we can find and discover a fresh resolve to follow him in grace, looking out for the poor and needy, as we too participate in his new beginning. So, to reflect a little bit then on what following Jesus might mean for you. I guess the question is, who will you involve in your networks and at your table? Who will you eat with? How will following Jesus affect your judgments, your prejudices, and your politics? Maybe there's a need for some realignment, attitudes and actions. And it could even mean realigning some ideas about how we understand God. Oh, yes, we know God, but how do we understand God? And how do we understand his action in the world? Let's pray together. There are times, Lord, where it is difficult to make the parallels and the connections from the stories of Jesus and the interactions he had with the people in his world to our world, and to try and understand what is right and how we follow, how we practice justice and what justice looks like, how we are merciful and what mercy looks like, how we exercise compassion and what compassion looks like. And sometimes that's not necessarily complicit. But the one thing I would know it not to be is it's never disrespectful. And the way that we express, the way that we speak truth to power, the way that we go about following you, that we might not confuse complicity with humility and just roll over and take things, but see that humility means we can practice respectfulness. As we speak truth to power, as we seek to follow the example of Jesus. There's a lot in this story about the identity of Jesus and who you really are, the Son of Man. Help us to order our priorities according to the drumbeat of your kingdom, of those that we will include, of those that we will respect, of those that we will value. And as we do, that we find our hearts growing all the more like yours because of the work of your Spirit within us. Father, we thank you for this wonderful story. Enable us that we can put into place the principles that we see here. In the name of Jesus, amen. I'm going to invite Sharon and the team to lead us through a song as we prepare for communion.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free. Oh, it is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold.
Said to you earlier today, I'm a self-confessed foodie, and I just love it when the family comes together around the table, where the terms of our acceptance and to enjoy the hospitality of God are really clearly spelled out to us to help remind us of the simple truths of a life that was given in death that we might beat death and live. The body he broke, the blood he shed. One of the great privileges for me as a follower of Jesus is the privilege to help other people to understand, come to terms with the not religion. Those of you who know me and getting to know me, I don't consider myself a particularly religious person, but relationships, for me, relationships are everything with God and with others. And that to me is not a religious pursuit, it's a whole of life thing, and not just a segmented part over here that says something else over there. Now, that's one of my blessings and my privileges, but we've got Alan and Alicia back with us this week. Alicia, I'm not going to touch that. Can you guys grab that one? The table for me is where we tell stories. It's where the God story is told, but it's where we share God's stories as well. And I'm itching to hear, because you guys have been away for doing a whole bunch of stuff. I want to hear some God stories, man. Come on.
Well, one of them
really big highlights was when we played in a pub in Blackall called the Baku Pub.
Yeah.
And we were just there sharing music, and we'd had done two sets for the night, and we had had our meal, and a young girl, because of the backpackers aren't travelling as much because of COVID, they're down in staff. So there was a young girl who's too young to work in the bar, but she could work in the kitchen. She said, "Have you finished with your plates?" And I said, "Yes, thank you." And I said to her, "How are you?" And she said, "Pretty good, except I've got pain in my knees. I walk with a limp because I've got sports injuries." I said, "Can I pray for you?" And she said, "Sure." So I stood up, and Alan stood up, and I said, "I can't do anything, but in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, be healed." And then I said to her, "Can you please walk up and down to show me that the limp and the pain's gone?" And she proceeded to walk up, walk back, and with a shocked expression on her face was like, "Wow, what just happened?" I said, "That's Jesus. God's just healed you." And so that then led to a conversation of Alan inviting her to come and hear us on the Sunday. And she said, "Can I hear your story now?" So I shared with her a bit of my testimony. And then I shared the gospel with her, just simple gospel message. And she said, "I have never heard words like this," which is quite, for about a 16-year-old, it's like the gospel needs to get out to the young people. So,
amen.
And so then I was had the privilege of leading her in a prayer to receive Jesus in the pub.
Wow, love
and
it.
God healed her too. God healed her first.
The glory of the Lord is over the whole earth as the water covers the seas. Fantastic.
And I'll let Alan share a highlight.
Praise God. That is just exciting. So, Al, you've been here, there and everywhere, man.
Yeah, we have. We're focusing on pubs at the moment, so you're getting another pub story. We actually do go into churches occasionally. But I love the Bible. I just love Jesus and where he went and the things that he done.
Yeah.
And I never wanted to go back into the pub environment. I actually was working as a paid musician 5 years ago when I came to faith. And I just didn't think that environment suited anymore. So I thought, no, I'm not going to do that. But for Jesus, we're actually going there now for free. And we're at the Tambo pub about a week before the Blackall pub. And we played there 3 nights. And I was reading the story of the prodigal son in the morning in this house we were staying at, that they run a little church so people don't have to travel 500 kilometres to go to church. Some of them only have to travel 200 kilometres each way. So they bought this little central house. And we were staying in a motorhome out the front of this house, and I was reading the prodigal son story, and it broke me in a way that it hadn't for years. And I was literally bawling because I know I've been a prodigal son. And then the next day we're walking down the street and we come across this guy called Basil, who we had seen for 3 nights at the pub, who's the cook there. And I really felt on my heart after talking to him, because he shared a little bit of his story, and I felt it was about him because he had been to youth as a child and his life was definitely not one that was still walking with God. And I said to Alicia, "I really feel I've got to pursue this guy." So I raced across the road, and God in his infinite wisdom, this guy just appeared in front of me from where he was coming from. I was going searching for him. And we stopped on the side of the road, and he gave his heart back to the Lord. And we connected into a local church. And I even had the pastor from Charleville last night message me and ask me his name, because he was working out there and he was in the bar. So to me, it's about just linking people into the communities of other believers and letting them know that God hasn't forgotten them. So, and they're all valuable. Every one of those people in the pub, God wants to have a relationship with, and also in the church. So,
amen. Just hang that one up for a minute, Al. That's wonderful. I don't want you to go away, but I haven't finished my family business this morning. Just stick around. If you want to pull up a stump with Tim and Jackie for a minute or three. The other little bit of family business, because I actually have a scripture to offer to you guys this morning. But I'm going to invite Luke to come down. Luke Cousins. This is family business time. And Luke has been with us since March 2020, and quite frankly, mate, you've kept us alive. You really have. The all-nighters that you've put in, those early days when we had no idea what we were doing, working with a 30-plus-year-old's analog system trying to jam all this signal through, coming out scrambled and gobbledygook on the other side. I have no idea how you did it, but you kept us alive. We've just, you know, we've done things like, you know, the minute of appreciation in our members' meetings to honour you. And we always knew that there would be a time where the formal side of your contract would conclude, but not the informal side, not the relationships. The relationships stay. But the formal side of things, Luke, I just can't find enough words on behalf of our elders, our leaders, our church. And you know I can wax lyrical, okay? I'm pretty good at it. But there just aren't enough words in the vocabulary to actually help me do this. So if I could extend to you an honorary PhD in the name of Maryborough Baptist Church, I would. And if I could extend honorary membership, I would. The best I can come up with is the status of friend of Maryborough Baptist Church. But can we give Luke a round of acclamation? And this is just to fill until I can get Sharon to make a real one, okay? Sharon to make a real one. But Luke, seriously, you've blessed my life personally. You've blessed us. Man, we're just so grateful to God for you. You really have been a gift of God to us. And I just want to say thank you. I just want to say thank you. Is there anything you'd like to say, mate? Yeah, you might want to. It's good.
I took my job, you know. I started this job because I wanted to say to. Sorry, public speaking is not my thing. Sorry. And good behind a console. But what I wanted to say was that the very first meeting that I had with Pastor Rhys and Tony about what we're doing and what we could do in this time of COVID and the shutdown and stuff like that, the main thing was, how do we treat people like human beings? That our brothers and sisters in Christ that are unable to come to worship with each other in corporate worship and hear God's message for them. And we talked about how we remove barriers for that. So what was supposed to be a 20-minute meeting ended up being 3 hours. And that's where we built the network. We built all the systems that just seem like they just flow because of the hard work that Rhys and Tony and the elders and everybody here doing what God's asked you to do. It's not me who's getting the honour here, it's what God has put into every one of you. His love for his people.
This will, this is not like the end of the road. This is just simply a marker where we are determined to honour what God has given us in giving us you. And the scripture that I have this morning, both for you and for Alan and Alicia, comes out of Revelation as we come to the table of God, Revelation 19 and following. Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory. For the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear. And the parenthesis that John puts down here, fine linen, stands for the righteous acts of the saints. So the work that you guys have been involved in out in the fields, the ripe, in the pubs and the highways and the byways, the work that you have been involved in here among us in just helping us sort through our engagement in the 21st century technological world, these are all righteous acts that are woven into the garments that we wear when he returns. And I just think to myself, you know, as is written, let us rejoice and be glad. Yes, honour one another, yes, but give him glory. Give him glory. Give him glory. Father, thank you so much for the stories that Alan and Alicia have shared with us this morning. And they're just a taster, just a little bit of salt on the tongue to cause us to thirst for more. Thank you so much for the blessing that Luke has been and is and continues to be for us. And Lord, as we gather around the table, the wonderful terms that bring to us life, that through Jesus' death we find the means of the wrong being taken out, that the right can be restored, and his resurrection that speaks to us indeed that right has been restored, and that we participate with you because of that which these elements represent. And so we say thank you for your grace to us all today. And Father, we bless you for your faithfulness that is on display among us. In the name of Jesus, amen. I'm going to ask Alan and Alicia to join with Tim and Jackie this morning to distribute the elements. Luke, thank you. When you receive the bread, and there's some gluten-free options there for bread, by all means, eat that as it comes. But hang on to your cup. Hang on to your cup that we can drink together. And everyone is welcome at God's table. You know, you don't have to be a member of the church. You don't have to be a member of this church or any other church. If you're with us this morning, you're welcome to participate. And even if you're still working out the issues of life and faith and what that means, don't feel that you're excluded from this. This isn't a ritual thing. This is a life-giving thing that speaks to us of life that comes in the wake and leaves death in its wake. So please be welcome to join with us in the celebration of communion this morning. Al, Tim, Alicia, Jackie, could you please? It really is a foodie sort of morning, isn't it? Isn't it a foodie sort of morning? I don't know about you, but I'm pretty full. Jesus, we're so grateful for our community and for your presence among us in our community. I'm so grateful for one another and that we can
stand together in the presence of greatness with you among us, that we can honour and respect one another. Lord, that we might continue to take these sacred moments into the wholeness of our lives and realise that the whole of our lives are sacred. And that the body broken, the blood shed, a life that we have not lived, a death that we have not died, that we can place our trust in for our eternity. And that we share in this cup together, symbolic of our unity in you, but looking forward to that day where you return, that we can share this cup together. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let's drink together. Nadine will come and and collect the cups from you, and invite them to the team to come back and to sing us out with the reprise. When Sharon looked at the song set this morning, she said, "I haven't got anything to go out with." And I said, "Yeah, you haven't, so that one." And I'll let her introduce it to you. Please join us for morning tea after our service this morning. Let's keep the conversations going. And for our online family, thanks for tuning in. We trust today's been a blessing to you. And be encouraged and be blessed as you continue to push into him and follow after him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand.
Stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken.
we have a new record. We have a new record. He has completely annihilated sin. He has completely cleansed us and made us whole again. And as He is, so are we in this world. And so, Father, we just thank You that as we go out today, as we go out into this new week, that we go with that record resonating within us, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and that we are Your sons and daughters in this world to represent the Father of all. Amen.